Welcome. I'm Doris Wise Montrose, President of Children of Jewish Holocaust Survivors. Before we begin, I know that we all pray for the safe and quick return of the three Israeli teenage boys kidnapped by the terrorists, Gilad Shaar, Naftali Frankel, and Ayel Yifra. I don't know if I pronounced it right. We all have the same feeling. Children of Jewish Holocaust survivors and the David Horowitz Freedom Center are very privileged and honored to have as our speaker tonight Cornell Law Professor William Jacobson, who will speak on the case for Israel and academic freedom. At the forefront of the fight against the American Studies Association, the ASA, academic boycott of Israel, Jacobson will argue that the boycott is anti-educational, anti-peace, and based on misconceptions and omissions about the history and the legality of the conflict. Professor Jacobson is the founder and publisher of two popular websites, Legal Insurrection and College Insurrection, which have covered the boycott, divest, and sanction movement for years. He has been cited in major publications such as the Jerusalem Post, the Times of Israel, Forbes, National Review, Commentary, and elsewhere. Through Legal Insurrection, Jacobson was instrumental in obtaining rejections of the academic boycott by over 250 university presidents and has filed a challenge to the ASA's tax-exempt status. Legal Insurrection, among other things, Legal Insurrection, Professor Jacobson, was instrumental in obtaining rejections, and I did repeat that, and I'm sorry about that. In May 2014, Professor Jacobson challenged 39 Vassar College professors who signed a boycott letter to a debate, not one accepted. Our gratitude, as always, to the Lux Hotel and their wonderful staff for providing the venue for our events. Professor Jacobson will take your questions following his presentation. At this time, kindly turn off your cell phones and other electronic devices. It is with great pleasure I introduce to you Professor William Jacobson.
Great, thank you. Thank you for that introduction, and thank you for welcoming me to your fine city. I've only been here a couple of times, and it's always great to be back. The topic tonight, and what I'm going to talk about, is the move for an academic boycott of Israel. You've probably heard the term BDS, boycott, divest, and sanction. Boycott, divest, and sanction is a very broad movement. It's to boycott everything from Sabra hummus in grocery stores or in school, in university cafeterias, to musicians, to a lot of different things. And I'm happy to talk about those things, particularly if you have questions during the question and answer. But for the most part, I'm going to focus on the academic boycott movement, because what you have is an international movement for the cultural and academic boycott of Israel. It goes beyond academics. But academics is what affects me the most, given my position. So the academic boycott movement is distinct, but it has a lot of similarities. And I do think that what you find with the recent kidnapping of the three Israeli teenagers, and most specifically the reaction, not from all, but from many of the Palestinian activists, and particularly the anti-Israel activists in the United States, is a celebration of that kidnapping. It's a good thing. They've started a symbol that they're placing photos on Facebook and elsewhere and on the internet of holding up three fingers, because three fingers is the victory for them of kidnapping the three Israeli teenagers. And I say it's a clarifying moment because it's what I face on campuses frequently. And what it is a complete dehumanization of Israeli Jews, and it necessarily bleeds into of Jews in general, but it's a complete dehumanization. And you see that when they can actually celebrate the kidnapping of three teenagers, none of whom are accused of a crime. This is not, they weren't arrested, they were kidnapped. And so the reason they dehumanize Israel, and you'll see in your packet a Nazi, literally Nazi, not neo-Nazi, Nazi era cartoon that was posted on Twitter and on Tumblr and on other social media by Students for Justice in Palestine. That's what it ends up with. When you've so dehumanized somebody, you end up passing around Nazi-era propaganda. But that's very important to the academic boycott movement, because academic boycotts are extremely, extremely rare. There are a lot of boycotts. I mean, every day in the paper, somebody's boycotting something over some dispute. But academic boycotts are extremely rare, particularly systematic academic boycotts. In fact, in the United States, at least, there was never a systematic academic boycott, even of South Africa. That there were economic boycotts, there were others. There might have been individuals or individual groups who boycotted South Africa academically, but there never was the sort of systematic academic boycott that they seek to impose on Israel. And I will describe for you how expansive that academic boycott is. But my argument, and when I present it on campuses to students, I understand the dynamics of what's happened on campuses in the last 30 years, and that any professor, not any professor, many professors that you meet, there's this generational divide. If they're basically 45 to 50 or older, you'll find a reasonable variety of views. Some are pro-Israel, some don't care, some are anti-Israel. But as you move into the younger generation, you find this extreme hostility among faculty towards Israel. So I like to go to the campuses and speak to the students. But I do understand that, whether it's in high school, college, grad school, they have been subjected to a decade or more of indoctrination. And so the argument that I use with the students to try to persuade the people who maybe are undecided is that you don't have to agree with me that I'm right on what I'm saying. All you have to be willing to do to be against the academic boycott is to acknowledge that there are two sides to the story. Because academic boycotts are so extreme and so rare and really reserved for those nations and those political systems which are deemed by the international community to be outside of humanity, like apartheid, that you only do that when there is no other side of the story. And that, so what I try to argue to them is that you don't have to accept that what I'm saying is correct. All you have to accept is that there are two sides to the story. And for the students on campuses, and we can talk about this more in the question and answer, there can be a sense of real isolation. Their professors, many of them are against them. The most vocal students, not necessarily the majority of students, but the real loudmouths on campus are against them. The student newspapers are often run by the people who are hostile to Israel. And so the message that I give to the students on campuses, and I think it's really important for, I know there are representatives here or people involved in various organizations, I think the message we all need to send to the students is that you're not alone. That you're not as isolated as you think you are. The Israel, in fact, in the United States is more popular than it's ever been. Gallup every year comes out with their favorability ratings. Israel's favorability rating as of March of this year was 72%. By comparison, there were only literally a handful that were higher than that. Not surprising, Canada, Britain, I think Japan, a couple of others. But Israel was pretty much close to the top, and certainly in the Middle East, it was far more popular than any other country. By comparison, the Palestinian Authority had a 19% favorability rating. And just to show you how popular Israel is, I, in doing some research, found another favorability rating survey. Now, it wasn't Gallup, so it may not have been, you know, the same methodology, but in the United States, there's a favorability rating of 71% for kittens. So Israel is actually more popular in the United States than kittens are. And I say that, and it's easy to laugh at that, but you have to, I tell the students, you're living in a bubble. What's happening on the campuses is not reflective of what's happening in the United States as a whole. Yes, there are, like the Presbyterian Church and a few other places, there are those pockets of hostility to Israel. But on a political level, on a national level, there really is no meaningful anti-Israel movement in the United States. But that doesn't make it any easier for the student, has to walk through the so-called, past the so-called apartheid wall that they erect on campuses, or has to deal with speakers being shouted down and things like that, or professors. One professor at Brown I had written about, she teaches something completely unrelated to the Middle East, had nothing to do with the course. On her course website, and I think it was an English or an American history or something course, on the course website, she was promoting Israeli Apartheid Week at Brown University. And believe me, and I'm sure the people who deal with the campuses know, the students feel that pressure, they really do. And so I try to tell them, deal with the pressure, but understand that that's not how it is in the United States, although it is to some extent how it is in Europe. And I think the European example shows you how negative these things can go, where there is no difference in Europe between anti-Zionism and anti-Semitism. And the violence against Jews in Europe is directly related to the relentless demonization and dehumanization of Israel. Israel is also less economically isolated. Despite what you read in the newspapers, their exports to the EU are actually up. They've signed trade deals with China. They're going to probably have expansive trade with India. The EU is a problem, but Israel in many ways is less isolated than it was. So why do I even talk about the academic boycott? And it's because of things like that poster. It's isolated to campuses, but it's a nasty, malicious ideology, and we should try to isolate it and try to fight it while it's small in the United States so we don't become a Europe where it gets traction. The reason I've been covering the BDS movement for several years. It's very interesting because I fought when I was a student in the early 1980s at Harvard Law School, the precursor to the BDS movement. And there were anti-Israel students on campus. Some of them became professors. They're now anti-Israel professors, and they're now leading the students in the BDS movement. And so I fought those sort of things. And it's very interesting how the tactics that were used back then are the tactics that are used now. They try to racialize the dispute. They try to portray it as people of color versus white colonialists. Put aside that's not Israel, but that's how they try to do it. And that's what they did back in the early 80s, and that's what they're doing now on the campuses. But I guess I react so viscerally against the academic boycott movement is because of at least one of my personal experiences. I was in college a Soviet studies major. I studied in the Soviet Union. I studied Russian language very intensively. And I don't recall anybody back then, despite the fact that the Soviets had thousands of missiles pointed at us, that we had proxy wars with each other going on around the world, I don't recall anybody calling for an academic boycott of Israel. In fact, it was just the opposite, of the Soviet Union. It was just the opposite. We wanted that interaction. We were starved to get over there and enroll in their schools. It was very limited ability to do that. I studied Russian language at Middlebury College during their summers and went to Moscow with Middlebury. And they would bring over a dozen or so Soviet Russian language teachers to teach during the summer at Middlebury. And we were thrilled about that. We knew what the score was. We knew that obviously they could only come over here alone, not with their family, because they didn't want defectors. We knew that they were certainly pre-cleared by the KGB for being loyal to the Soviet Union. And we also assumed that they were actually reporting on us. Maybe not on every single student, but certainly on some students. Despite all that, we wanted to interact with them. We felt that was really important, despite the history of the Soviet Union, which of course is not taught anywhere on campus anymore. The forced collectivization that killed millions, the Gulag Archipelago, the deportation of entire nationalities. I mean, when I mention this fact to audiences, they look at me with this blank stare. I mean, why is the Crimea so heavily Russian? It's heavily Russian because in 1944, Stalin put the entire population of the Crimean Tatars on trains and trucks and drove them to Siberia and to Uzbekistan. That's why it's 98% Russian speaking. Nobody knows that anymore. We knew it at the time. The invasion of Finland, the Baltic states, Hungary, no academic freedom in the Soviet Union. If you were to speak out in any way, you'd lose your position in the university. No freedom of movement. In fact, I was on the last Aeroflot flight out of New York from Moscow after we had closed their embassy, their consulate in New York, because they invaded Afghanistan. So they shut down the consulate, they suspended Aeroflot's flying rights. So my group of 10 American students was on the Aeroflot flight with all the Soviet diplomats who'd been kicked out, and we were going to boycott them, but nobody was talking about the academic boycott. And so when I look at the situation, of all of the things the Soviet Union actually was, the mass murder, the genocide, the forced collectivization, the actual transfer of populations, real ethnic cleansing, not the phony ethnic cleansing they claim Israel's engaged in, all of those things, worse than Israel is even accused of being, nobody wanted to academically boycott. We felt that in some small way, our being there and our interacting with their people on the street, with their students, with their academics, was somehow undermining that system, that that free flow of information and exchange of academic ideas was a good thing, even when you were doing it with a system that you knew to be bad. And that analysis does not get applied when it comes to Israel. It doesn't get applied when it comes to any country. It gets applied to any country except for Israel. You could have an academic exchange with Iran. You could have an academic exchange with a whole lot of countries, and nobody objects to it. It's only Israel. So I react viscerally to that. The other anecdote I'll talk to you about, not a big fan of Thomas Friedman, but he actually had an interesting column a couple of months ago about a MOOC, M-O-O-C, that's a massive online something or something, where students can interact with the professors online. It's more than just watching a video or something like that. There's actually a mechanism for interaction. It's supposed to be the wave of the future. So Technion held a MOOC on nanotechnology, and it was organized and paid for by the university, and it was for students from mostly the Arab and the Muslim world. And as of the time of Friedman's column, 4,800 students from countries including Egypt, Syria, Saudi Arabia, Jordan, Iraq, Kuwait, Algeria, Morocco, Sudan, Tunisia, Yemen, et cetera, and including the Palestinian territories, had signed up to take this educational course with an Israeli professor at Technion because they were so starved for that knowledge and that academic interaction that they were willing to do that. They quoted the professor who was running it for Technion, who said that in the Middle East, if the Middle East was like Technion, we would already have peace. In the pure academy, you feel totally equal with every person, and you're appreciated based on your excellence. That MOOC and that professor is an Israeli Arab. And so the American Studies Association, which I'll talk about in a little while, and these academic boycotts would rather deprive those 4,800 students from Muslim countries of education than interact with Israel. The other thing I learned from that is that 19% of Technion students today are Israeli Arabs, which mirrors almost precisely within a digit or two of the percentage of the population that's not Jewish. This is, again, the institution that they would want to boycott. What is academic freedom? I think it means a lot of different things. It certainly means protection of job security, that you don't get fired because of the research you're doing or the position you're taking. That's one aspect of it. But the American Association of University Professors, which, by the way, is against the academic boycott of Israel, came out with a definition many years ago in 2005 in reaction to a proposed British boycott of Israeli universities, and defined it as the academic freedom is the free exchange of ideas among academics, irrespective of government policies and however unpalatable those policies may be viewed. And they issued certain guidelines, and they concluded that while every individual professor has the right to interact with whomever he or she wants, when such non-cooperation takes the form of a systematic academic boycott, it threatens the principles of free expression and communication on which we collectively depend. And therefore, that's why academic boycotts are not the norm, that they are almost never invoked, and you need really the highest standard when you're going to try to do that. And that's why I said you really need that one-sided coin. When there's one side of the story and there is no legitimate other side, then you can start even talking about an academic boycott. But when there are two sides to the story, at least the largest professors' organization in the country says you should not be engaging in a systematic boycott. The history of boycotts in Land of Israel started at least as early as 1920, directed against Jews in the then British Mandate of Palestine. The Arab League was formed in 1944 and instituted its boycott of Jewish businesses in the Middle East in 1945, before Israel was even a state. So the history of boycotts in the Middle East is the history of boycotts of Jews. It's not the history of boycotts of people you merely disagree with. It's a Jewish boycott. It's the Arab League boycott, and it's directed against the national aspirations of the Jewish people. The modern boycott, the so-called BDS movement, is a direct outgrowth of the 2001 Durban conference, which was so anti-Semitic that the US actually walked out on the conference. And the late Congressman Tom Lantos attended that, and he wrote about that. And I'll just read you very briefly what he wrote. He said that at a press conference held by Jewish NGOs, non-governmental organizations, to discuss their concerns with the direction the conference was taking, an accredited NGO, the Arab Lawyers Union, distributed a booklet filled with anti-Semitic caricatures, frighteningly similar to those seen in the Nazi hate literature printed in the 1930s. Jewish leaders and I who were in Durban were shocked at this blatant display of anti-Semitism. For me, having experienced the horrors of the Holocaust firsthand, this was the most sickening and unabashed display of hate for Jews I'd seen since the Nazi period. Sadly, but perhaps not surprisingly, the official NGO document that was later adopted by a majority of the NGOs in the forum branded Israel a racist apartheid state, guilty of genocide, and called for an end to its racist crimes against the Palestinians. They then issued a statement from that anti-Semitic forum, which called upon the international community to impose a complete and total isolation of Israel as an apartheid state. So when you hear all this language, and I'll explain to you why it's inaccurate about Israel being an apartheid state, it didn't just happen. That was the deliberate strategy developed at the anti-Semitic Durban conference to try to isolate Israel, to try to equate it to South Africa, and to try to impose the sort of economic, cultural, and academic boycott that was imposed on South Africa. And it didn't just happen. So you'll often hear them excuse it by saying, well, this is just Palestinian civil society deciding to make this call for a boycott. No, it's not. It was actually a strategy developed at the Durban conference. It took Palestinian groups 2 to 3 years to gather up enough groups, and in July 2005, they issued their final declaration of boycott, which calls upon, we, the representatives of Palestinian civil society, call upon the international civil society all over the world to impose broad boycotts and implement divestment initiatives against Israel similar to those applied to South Africa in the apartheid era. That call by so-called Palestinian civil society, which was planned at the Durban conference and took them 2 or 3 years to put together, that call for a boycott is the call for a boycott that the American Studies Association agreed to abide by in December of 2013. So they have agreed to abide by a boycott call, which was rooted in anti-Semitism, rooted in Nazi-era literature. And that's why it's not a surprise to me to see the Students for Justice in Palestine at Vassar College pass around Nazi literature. That doesn't mean that every single person who participates hates Jews or thinks of themselves that way, but that's where it started. And that's where it's heading, certainly in Europe. The Palestinian groups issued under what they call the Palestinian Campaign for the Cultural and Academic Boycott of Israel. It's actually an entity. It's got a website where it publishes all of these things. There's an American equivalent of that, started by a professor. I think he used to be at UC Riverside. I forget where he is now. I don't think he's there anymore. The American equivalent of that. And they issued academic boycott guidelines. Because it's one thing for the Palestinian civil society groups to issue this boycott call, but how are we actually going to do it? What does it mean? What am I allowed to do and what can I do? And they issued guidelines. And the guidelines, among other things, and I'm not going to read all of them, prohibit interaction at academic events such as conferences, symposia, workshops, book and museum exhibits convened or co-sponsored by Israeli institutions, bars institutional cooperation agreements with Israeli universities or research institutes, bars exchange of faculty and students to conduct or conduct the conduct of joint research, bars study abroad schemes in Israel for international students. So many colleges have study abroad in Israel. That's barred. Bars addresses and talks at international venues by official representatives of Israeli academic institutions, such as presidents and rectors. Bars Palestinian-Israeli collaborative research projects, because it's widely known, I'm reading from their guideline, it is widely known that the easiest route to securing a research grant for a Palestinian academic is to apply with an Israeli partner. They would rather that the Palestinian academic not get a grant than have that Palestinian do it jointly with an Israeli academic. They bar institutional membership, or they would bar institutional membership of Israeli associations in world bodies. And what to me is perhaps in many ways the most chilling is they would bar publishing in or refereeing articles for academic journals based at Israeli universities. So it's not quite book burning, but it's book suppression, if you want to use it that way. What I just read to you are the guidelines for the boycott call that the American Studies Association has agreed to abide by. Here's the language from the resolution. It is resolved that the American Studies Association endorses and will honor the call of Palestinian civil society for a boycott of Israeli academic institutions. And if there's any doubt, and I've researched this extensively, if there's any doubt, throughout their materials and throughout the materials leading to the passage of the resolution, they repeatedly refer to the guidelines that I spoke to you about. Those guidelines were so offensive that in the run-up to the resolution at the American Studies Association, even some of the anti-Israel people got a little queasy about this, because this is really a total shutdown of academic interaction. And so the American Studies Association issued something, and they literally called it talking points. They issued to their members talking points because they expected pushback from universities and others about how this boycott is really going to work. But they never actually reject any of the guidelines. They simply say that, well, we don't really boycott individuals. And if you look at their guidelines and you look at everything they've done to scale this back, they keep coming back to the claim that they don't boycott individuals. Well, I've just read you what the guidelines are. When you have it would be like saying that I'm going to boycott this hotel. And not only are we not going to stay here, we're going to intimidate companies that they don't sell goods to this hotel. And we're going to go through 10 levels of boycott of this hotel. Does that mean you're not boycotting the employees here? Does that mean you're not boycotting the owner here? Of course you are. And when you institute a boycott of an institution, of course you're boycotting individuals. It's ludicrous. Yet that is one of their first responses when they get pushed. Well, no, we can still interact with individual Israelis. And to some extent that's true, but you're boycotting their institutions. You're boycotting where they work. Of course you're boycotting them. And in fact, if they carry an official title, if they're a dean, so assuming Tel Aviv University has an assistant dean for academic affairs, like many universities have here, that person is automatically boycotted without exception because they carry an official title. If you're a representative, if you're going to attend a conference, if you are a representative of your university. So you're not there in your purely individual capacity. You are there as a representative or ambassador from an Israeli university. You will be barred. That is a litmus test that is not applied to any other country in the world. Assuming North Korea has universities, and assuming they'd let somebody out, you could come to an American Studies conference as the assistant dean of Pyongyang University, and you're welcome. You could come there if you're there as a representative of Tehran University, and you're welcome. Nobody's going to ask a question. But if you're there and you're from Tel Aviv University, you have to show that you're not there in an official or representative capacity. And it's done based solely on your national origin of being affiliated with an Israeli university. Now, don't get me wrong. I think representatives from Tehran University should be able to come here and interact with us. I'm not arguing that they shouldn't. But to single out Israel among all the horrific regimes in the world and apply a litmus test to it that is applied to nobody else, to me, I think is arguably against the law. But it's certainly offensive. And it's certainly not true when they tell you that they don't boycott individuals. So whose academic freedom does it damage? Well, obviously, it damages the Israelis' academic freedom. They're not able to participate in these events. It damages, though, way beyond that. It damages US universities. If the American Studies Association proponents of the boycott had their way, what the American Studies has adopted would be adopted not only by every professional organization, but by every university. But who would suffer? US universities and scholars could not interact with Israelis. So that whole body of knowledge that's developed in Israel would not be allowed here. The general academic community is damaged by it, because you are deprived, think of medical advances, scientific advances, all those advances that come from joint cooperation. Most important when I'm on campus, and the students never think of it this way, the students' academic freedom is subject to this boycott, that they lose their academic freedom because there are no trips to Israel. At Vassar University and Vassar College, and I keep coming back to Vassar because I was talking to somebody from the Horowitz Center, and Vassar is really kind of culled down. It's really, you know, you've boiled the stew and here's what's left of how nasty it's gotten there. They actually picketed a class because it involved a 2-week trip to Israel. It wasn't even a politics class. It was a class regarding water ecosystems. And their trip was going to involve travel both in Israel and in the Palestinian territories to study water systems. And Students for Justice in Palestine picketed the course with signs asking students to drop the course. Okay. That's how bad it got. I spoke to the professor, interviewed the professor, because I wrote it up on my website. And she's somebody who is, you know, probably leans a little bit towards the kind of leftist, quasi-anti-Israel sort of milieu that is existing, that she's not like real pro-Israel. I mean, she wasn't taking the trip there because she's pro-Israel, but she's not, you know, overtly hostile either, but kind of more towards the hostile than the pro. And she was absolutely floored. She could not believe that they picketed her course. And that they literally had to walk the picket, they had to cross the picket line, she and her students, to get to class. She was horrified by it. And she said the students in her class were absolutely horrified. She said they were like shell-shocked. They didn't even hold the class, they held the class, but they spent the class talking about what they just experienced. Because as they were walking through there, the Students for Justice in Palestine were making the sound, and I certainly can't reproduce the sound, but I think it's called ululation or ulation. It's that sound that is in Middle East. They had to walk through picketers making that sound just to get to their classroom. And so the students get affected. Had it been up to Students for Justice in Palestine, there never would have been that class that went to Israel and went to Palestinian territories to interact. And their itinerary went over there. It was not like real pro-Israel itinerary. I mean, I've seen the itinerary. It was mostly interacting with Palestinian groups more so than Israeli groups. Yet even that they did not want to happen. And so the school's response, if you can believe this, the school's response when the professors complained about what had happened was to organize an open forum on campus to discuss the ethics of traveling to Israel. Not to discuss what the students had done, but to discuss the ethics. When the professors pushed back against that, they changed the title of it to discussing activism. And in that open forum, and I've interviewed several people who were there, including the professors, it was basically an Israel hate fest. It was 200 people packed into a room, led by a professor who started off by saying, "We don't need any cardboard notions of civility here tonight." Okay, an English professor. And they spent, and the professors were shocked. What happened in that meeting, I wish it was videotaped, was so over the top that there's a very virulently anti-Israel author, Philip Weiss, who runs a horrible blog called Mondo Weiss, which he was there and he wrote about it. And he said even he was shaken by the anti-Israeli atmosphere in the room. He said it was really over the top. The president of Vassar College, while she did condemn the Nazi cartoon, has specifically stated, and we have the videotape, that she never has condemned the student picketing of the course. And she made very clear that she never has condemned that. And so whose academic freedom is damaged by this? Everybody's. This is not like boycotting Sabra hummus in your, you know, dorm cafeteria. I mean, I'm against that boycott, but it's qualitatively different than the academic boycott, because the academic boycott destroys the entire system. It's anti-educational. And that's one of the bases for my challenge to the American Studies Association's tact-exempt status, is that they are now engaging, since they are an educational exempt organization, and the conduct they're engaging in is actually anti-educational, that they are engaged in non-exempt conduct, and therefore they have no right to be tax exemption. Needless to say, that's over at the IRS. Who knows when and if we'll ever hear from them. But it's important. It's important that. So the message that I give to students is that your professors, and remember, all of this is being done, or most of it is being done, by professors. You know, your professors have no right to determine what you read, what you write, or who you interact with. That is a usurpation of your education for their political purposes, and that students do not have to accept that as a reality. I also make the point that, and many others have, where does this stop? I mean, think about the United States. We were colonized. I mean, we had colonies. We called them colonies. Or the British called them colonies, and they became the United States. Virtually every university in the United States sits on land that at one point or another was Native American land. The U.S. has invaded other countries. We had slavery here. We had segregation. Certainly, any of these Israel boycotters will tell you in a heartbeat that there's still institutional racism here. Why aren't these people boycotting their own universities? If you applied to the United States the standard that they apply to Israel, they should be boycotting their own universities. And I've issued on my website an open call for them to do so, to quit. Not one of them has taken me up on that. And not one of them has taken up their own challenge. The Vassar professors who signed, the 39 Vassar professors who would not debate me at Vassar, in their letter published in the student newspaper, by the way, a day or two before this picketing took place, say that, you know, some of us signing this letter agree that if we were asked to boycott U.S. universities, we would do so. But not one of them has done so. And why not? Well, nobody asked them to do it. That's one of the reasons that they frequently will cite. They'll actually write this. Well, we're doing this because Palestinian civil society has asked us to do it. I mean, think how childish that is. Somebody asked you to do something, and that's your justification for doing it? So I asked the Vassar professors to resign and boycott the university. They have not one has done it yet. So they can't say nobody asked them. I asked them. The next thing they'll cite is, why are we singling out Israel? Well, U.S. aid to Israel, that we have a special obligation to police Israel and to hold Israel accountable because we give so much aid to Israel. And it is true, Israel receives about $3 billion a year in military aid. It's literally entirely military aid. I think of $3 billion, $30 million is some joint humanitarian project, but the rest is military. And of course, we all know the secret, the not-so-secret of U.S. military aid to other countries is that most of it comes right back to the United States because it's used to purchase U.S. hardware, it keeps our assembly lines running, it benefits the United States. That's not saying Israel gets no benefit, and that's not saying it doesn't cost the U.S. taxpayer anything, but much of it comes right back to the United States. Per capita, what's interesting is I never knew this, that the Palestinian Authority gets about $450 million a year from the U.S. taxpayers, and most of that is not military aid. So most of it stays over there, ends up probably in Swiss bank accounts of Palestinian officials, but at least ostensibly it's there. If you do the per capita, okay, Israel gets $3 billion, Palestinian Authority gets $450 million, but these are not equivalent-sized populations. If you do it per capita, Israel is getting about twice as much aid as the Palestinians, but it's not this warped ratio that you would be led to believe. Palestinian education, we'll say, has been stifled by Israel. Does anybody know how many universities there were in what was then called the West Bank and Gaza, controlled by Jordan and Egypt, prior to 1967? Zero. There are over 20 now. That's not to say the educational system there is ideal. And yes, there are checkpoints. There is the separation barrier, the security barrier. But that was a reaction to terrorism. But the fact of the matter is that there are thriving universities in Palestinian territories, many of which are very openly hostile to Israel. And it was Birzeit University where the students erected a monument celebrating Sparrow Pizza Massacre when the suicide bomber. So to say that while it's not a perfect situation for education, well, where is it a perfect situation in the Middle East for education? Look what happens, you know, certainly in Syrian universities nowadays, but in Egyptian universities, at Iranian universities, all of these things, but they're not singled out. Israeli education, as I mentioned, Technion is 19% Israeli Arab. University of Haifa is 30%. All of Israeli higher education is 11% Israeli Arab, as compared to about 20% of the population. So it's less, but show me all of the elite liberal arts universities and colleges in the US where the percentage of African Americans is what it is in the United States. You're not going to find many where 11% of the student population is African American. In fact, you'll find most of them where it's 2, 3, 4, 5%. So how can you complain when Israel actually provides better access to its higher education system to Israeli Arabs than the United States does to African Americans? They say that Israel is an apartheid state, and this is the biggest lie of all. And unfortunately, the propaganda use of the term has become so ingrained that it's now used inaccurately by John Kerry and even by some Israeli politicians. But what was South African apartheid? It was a system of control by a minority over a majority based on classic racial classifications. And when I say classic, nowadays in the social sciences, they can come up with crazy theories that makes anything a racial issue. But In South Africa, it was white and it was black and it was mixed race. You didn't need a social scientist to know that it was racism in South Africa. The non-white majority there had virtually no rights and was systematically excluded from the rule of law. That concept of this unique racial classification system and racial domination system was then embodied in a number of international treaties, most prominently the Rome Statute, creating the International Criminal Court in 1998, which states that for the purpose of the statute, crime against humanity means certain types of acts, one of which is the crime of apartheid. So under international law, apartheid is considered a crime against humanity. And it means inhumane acts of a character that they describe elsewhere, essentially criminal acts of a character, for an institutionalized regime of systematic oppression and domination by one racial group over any other racial group or groups. And that language is very, very important because it's the systematic domination by a racial group over another racial group. And what you find is that in Israel, it's not a racial dispute. Israel itself, the Jewish population, is multiracial. Israel's gone to great lengths to rescue non-white communities around the world. Half, more or less half of the population either are refugees from Arab countries or the descendants of refugees from Arab countries. So Israel is a multiracial entity, even among the Jewish population. Israel is a majority rule country. It's one person, one vote. That's not what it was in South Africa. That's not what it is in many places around the world. Even in Iran, it's one person, one vote, but they get to choose who gets to run. It has to be approved by the Ayatollahs. So it's not quite that. Israel, it is a mostly, it's not even an ethnic dispute, it's mostly a religious dispute. But to no other country is the term apartheid applied when it is a religious dispute. Because if religious domination constituted apartheid, then every country that has adopted in whole or in part Islamic law would have to be deemed an apartheid state. But that's not how anybody uses the term. It's only used when the majority population and the dominant religion is Judaism. It's not used any place else that way. Israeli Arabs have the protection of Israeli law. May not be perfect. Protection of minority rights may not be perfect in Israel, but what nation in the world is it perfect? They get to vote in elections. They get to elect members to Knesset if they have enough votes. It is true that a different law applies in the West Bank, but this is one of those situations where you're damned if you do, damned if you don't. There's a very strong argument that if Israel tried to apply Israeli law in Judea and Samaria to Palestinians, that that itself would be a violation of international law. So if they don't apply Israeli law to them, they're accused of being an apartheid state. If they did apply Israeli law to them, they'd be accused of violating international law. But they get to vote. It's not true that Palestinians don't get to vote. They get to vote in Palestinian elections, the ones who are not in Israel proper. And the fact that there haven't been such elections, the fact that Mahmoud Abbas is in year 8 or whatever it is of his 4-year term, is not Israel's fault. I mean, the reason is because if they held a popular election, Hamas would probably win to this day. So Israel bears none of these resemblances to apartheid as it existed in South Africa. Yet at the Durban conference, that's the strategy they decided. It gets repeated ad nauseum. If you hear the anti-Israeli speakers who come to campus, and the Stand With Us people know who they are, every other word out of their mouth is apartheid, apartheid, Israeli apartheid. They can give a 5-minute speech and say it 1,000 times. And it takes on, it's the big lie. If you repeat it enough, even some Israeli opposition politicians and John Kerry say, well, if Israel were to absorb the population, the Arab population in the Palestinian territories. And even if it were to not give them the vote, and if it were to not give them the vote, that would be an apartheid state. Well, no, it wouldn't. It would not be a democratic state, but it would not be an apartheid state because it still would not be a racial domination the way that South Africa was. It would be wrong, but it wouldn't make it apartheid. The so-called apartheid wall. At campuses, they erect apartheid walls to show students how bad Israel is and how you have to go through checkpoints. And I have yet to see at these mock walls, once, a mock suicide bomber. I guarantee you, if you asked students involved in these things, why was it built? They will tell you, well, because Israel wanted to steal land. They probably don't even understand or know that in 2002, 457 Israeli civilians were killed in suicide bombings. And that the construction of the security barrier was not the only reason that dropped, but it was one of the most important reasons. That and the checkpoints, which have now mostly been removed, except at major points of entry into Israel. And so that is never talked about. The other big lie, or I shouldn't say it's a lie, the other big gross oversimplification that I think is misleading is the claim that Israeli control of Judea and Samaria is illegal under international law. That's a disputed proposition. You can find very credible people to take either side of that issue. The history is that the entire mandate of Palestine, British mandate, was supposed to be the homeland for the Jewish people, with a saving clause that allowed the British to kind of break off Jordan, which they did pretty quickly. But what we think of now is Palestine, which is everything part of British mandate except for Jordan, was designated as the Jewish homeland by the League of Nations. Under international law, as it existed and has never been rescinded, that is the homeland of the Jewish people. In the 1948 War of Independence, Jordan illegally occupied what it then named the West Bank. The Jordanian occupation was illegal. It was against international law. It was recognized by only two countries, Britain and Pakistan. International community never recognized Jordan's territorial occupation of what it called the West Bank and part of Jerusalem. When Israel captured those territories, it was recapturing territory designated under international law to be part of the Jewish homeland, which had been illegally occupied by a country whose occupation was only recognized by two countries. Another thing I didn't even know until recently, in 1964, the original Palestinian National Charter, and I actually had somebody find it for me at an official Palestinian site, because I said, this can't be true. But the original charter, which is hard to find online, they only show mostly the 1968 version after the 67 war. 1964 version of the Palestinian National Charter, which created the PLO, the alleged sole and legitimate representative of the Palestinian people. Article 24, this organization does not exercise any territorial sovereignty over the West Bank in the Hashemite Kingdom of Jordan, on the Gaza Strip, or in the Hima area. Hima area is essentially Jordan. So think about what this simple statement, Israel's occupation of the West Bank is illegal under international law. Think about what it means. It means that it's the opposite of what the international law was. And there are theories that people have come up with as to why it should be a violation of international law, et cetera. But, you know, it's not the simplest of explanations. The simplest explanation is that Israel was reclaiming territory designated for it under international law to be part of the Jewish homeland. And it was territory, at least as regards to where Jordan occupied the West Bank, that the PLO had expressly disavowed any territorial claim to. So I don't say that people who say that Israel's quote-unquote occupation is illegal under international law. There are legitimate arguments that it is. They're convoluted, but there are arguments that it is. But there are also arguments on the other side. But to state, as a matter of fact, as if it's not disputed, that that is illegal, Israel's control, is just not true. It's such a gross oversimplification. And that's why the Israeli government properly refers to it as disputed territory. Of course, it is disputed. It's really unclear under international law whose territory it should be, whose national territory it should be. There never having been a Palestinian national entity of any form. So that's another thing that you'll hear. And last but not least, and I could go through a lot of these, you'll often hear, there are 30 Israeli laws discriminating against non-Jews. There are 50. Sometimes I see them say there are 100. But if you go through those, and actually a lot of the research that I've seen at CAMRA and other places has been very helpful for this, that you can kind of divide those laws into a few different categories. One of them is that anything that bears a Jewish or Hebrew symbol, they consider to be discriminatory. And so the Israeli flag, whatever the law was that designated the Israeli flag to be what it is, that they will put on their list of a discriminatory law, which means that the flag of Norway should be called discriminatory, the flag of a lot of countries, flags that bear the, you know, Islamic symbolism should be declared discriminatory. But nobody does that. That's only done when it comes to a symbol that relates to Judaism. Then they have a whole set of laws that in the US we would call disparate impact laws, that they're not on their face discriminatory, but they have more of an impact on non-Jews than they have on Jews. And one example that I noted when I spot checked their list was that Israel passed a law saying that the government has the right to revoke the citizenship of anyone convicted of treason. And the reason that's discriminatory is to say, well, Israeli Arabs are more likely to commit treason. Therefore, that law has a disparate impact on Israeli Arabs. I mean, that's what they get to. And then they have laws that they say apply exclusively to Jews, like Jewish-only roads. Well, there aren't Jewish-only roads. There are Israeli-only roads. And the reason, of course, they were built in Judea and Samaria is to try to avoid rock throwing and shots being fired and firebombing of his cars with Israeli license plates. So this is their excuses. We all know why Israel is singled out. I mean, there's, you know, the elephant in the room, okay, that nobody likes to talk about, at least not on campuses. And the reason it's singled out is that it's Jewish. And that's what it comes down to. The boycotts in the 1920s were because they were Jewish. The Arab League boycott was because it was Jews. The Durban Conference was because it was Jews. The BDS movement is because it's a Jewish national entity. That's what it is. And so a lot of people say to me, well, is this anti-Semitic? And I don't like to throw around that terminology just loosely, just like I don't like it when people accuse others of being racist just because they disagree with somebody's policy on education, or you know, Islamophobic just because they disagree with something. I don't like when that terminology is thrown around too loosely because it cheapens it, it demeans it. Just like the loose use of the term apartheid has cheapened what the horror really was of the apartheid system. The best explanation that I've heard for it was by Lawrence Summers, the former president of Harvard University, who said that the American Studies boycott is anti-Semitic in effect, if not intent. And it is, in my view, anti-Semitic in effect, if not intent. It doesn't matter if Jewish Voice for Peace supports it, and they're always put out in front. Okay, you look at a lot of the college speakers for the divestment motions, they'll put out the Jewish Voice for Peace students first, because it gives cover for everything else. It doesn't matter that they're Jewish. It's anti-Semitic in effect, because it so dehumanizes Jewish Israelis that it inevitably leads to what happened at Vassar with the Nazi cartoon, and it inevitably leads to the violence that we see in the streets of Paris and elsewhere. What was the reaction to the American Studies Association boycott? I can tell you one thing, it wasn't what they expected. I mean, maybe they expected to be greeted as liberators or something like that, but immediately we started contacting university presidents, and we published our letter to the president in our website, and we encouraged readers to contact the universities. And it was not twisting their arm, it's saying, here are the facts, here's what happened. Do you support this boycott or not? And very quickly we began to get responses, which we also published. And as of this date, over 250 university presidents have issued statements against the academic boycott of Israel. We'd accumulated, and I should say that we weren't the only ones contacting universities. I will say we were probably the first, because we don't have, you know, decision-making trees. I mean, I decide let's do it, and we do it. It's like running a small business, you just do it. You don't have to get approvals. But once we had gathered 20 or 25 of these, now we could go to university presidents and say, here's the list of 25, why aren't you on it? And other Jewish organizations also got involved. And that really was a pushback. There was some legislative pushback, which I think was counterproductive because it was rushed through and it was overly broad, but it was not what they expected. The American Council on Education, which is an enormous group, I'd never heard of them, but they're enormous. They represent like 2,000 institutions of higher education in the United States. So virtually all of the universities and colleges, they came out very strongly against it. The American Association of University Professors, I've mentioned, came out against it. The Association of American Universities, which is an organization of 60 large universities, private universities, I believe mostly, came out against it. Various public land grant, the Central Organization for Land Grant, which mostly is in the South, came out against it. The university presidents were in many ways the adults in the room. And because the reason is that when you start an academic boycott war, you don't know where it stops. Are we going to picket classes and try to coerce students into dropping it? And if Students for Justice in Palestine can do that, can pro-Israel students do that to classes run by anti-Israel professors? I mean, is that what we're going to get into? So where are we? I think it's fair to say, what's the assessment of where we are? And that's usually what the questions are, and I love to take questions. And you can ask difficult questions too, not just softball questions. Where are we on campus? I think this was an enormous wake-up call to a relatively sleepy community, which recognized the problem, but now it's front and center. And I think in the long run, that wake-up call was needed. And it's there, and there are organizations doing a really good job. But I encourage alumni and parents to get involved. Don't buy into the faculty line that by you getting involved, you're infringing their academic freedom. Academic freedom, I've gone over to you what it means. One thing it doesn't mean is freedom from criticism. And that's the way they treat it. That how dare you criticize this professor who wants to spend the semester indoctrinating students to be anti-Israel. Vassar has a very good, it's new, but it's good, parent alumni organization. And the parents are mortified that they're spending 60 grand a year to send their kids to this indoctrination camp. And I encourage you, and I encourage you, if you're an alum and you donate, make it clear to the university that you don't have to donate if they're gonna support this stuff. But I would say go even further. Don't just withhold funds. If you would have given them $2,000 this year, give it to one of the Israeli pro-Israel groups that are doing great work on campus. Make a negative into a positive. And they didn't put me up to that, I guarantee you. But that's what you need to do. You need to sponsor maybe your own lecture series. Instead of donating and having your name put on the classroom, start a series where you're going to bring over Israeli academics, an Israeli academic once a year to give a talk on campus. Make it a positive thing. And with that, I will open it up to questions.
Thank you. out of courtesy, because I know there's a lot of questions, please limit your statements to a question.
Thank you for your excellent talk. The one thing I have to say, Joe, is to the ultimate purposes. The ultimate purpose of this appears to me the destruction of Israel. That's what the ultimate purpose of it is. And if we counter on that, that's a means of going on the offensive, not always being on the defensive. Israel right now appears to be like a diplomatic moment. Everybody has the right to throw a harpoon at it. I think it's time for the whale to begin sinking the ship and turn it around and go on the offensive on this thing.
Well, I think that's a good point, that they deliberately try to be vague about what the ultimate goal is. And if you listen to what they say among themselves, and if you listen to what their founders and their leaders say, they do not consider Israel a legitimate state. They do not consider Jewish national presence in the Middle East to be a legitimate entity. And therefore, that is their ultimate goal. But they don't come out and say that a lot on campuses, because they know that's a harder line for them to sell to students, that you actually want to destroy the state of Israel. So they usually try to couch it as, well, we just want the occupation to end. And if you read their literature, they say they want to end the occupation of all Palestinian lands. They never define what those are. They consider Tel Aviv occupied territory.
So,
yeah. The question was why the Presbyterian Church has been so energetic, and I don't have the answer to it. I'm only familiar with what they've been doing in a very general way. But it's not just the Presbyterian Church. The American Friends Service, the Quakers, have been the worst. They run a BDS camp every summer. Look it up. Where they bring dozens and dozens of students to their camp, specifically to train them in the BDS movement. So while the evangelicals are extremely supportive of Israel, I think most Catholics groups are, although maybe they're just not as involved in the issue. But the two groups that stand out to me are the Presbyterians, but even worse than the Presbyterians have been the American Friends Service.
In a recent vote with Herbert, the Modern Language Association, when it went before the full body, it was a 94-6 rejection of the BDS motion.
Well, it wasn't 90. What it was is that 90-some-odd percent didn't bother to vote, and the way that they had it structured, they had to obtain at least 10, in order for the resolution to pass, and it wasn't a boycott resolution, it was a resolution asking the State Department to investigate denial of visas to academics wishing to visit what they called the West Bank.
There were two votes. One was the small committee up front.
There was the House of Delegates that voted, I believe, in January, as to whether these would even go to the full membership vote, because the House of Delegates can pass something, but it doesn't become is not binding until approved by both the Board of Directors and the membership. And so there were two resolutions presented at the House of Delegates. One was expressing sympathy with the American Studies Association. That failed. The second started out as a resolution condemning Israeli quote-unquote arbitrary denials of visas. There was pushback by some pro-Israeli professors, and they stripped out the arbitrary language. So they now asked the State Department to investigate denials. That went to a full vote over like a 6-week period of time, 8 weeks, and 1,500 voted for it, 1,200 voted against it, but they didn't have enough voting for it because they needed 10% of the membership, so it failed. That's a perfect example of how small groups can try to take over a big organization. Because if they didn't have that bylaw, 6% of the membership would have bound the entire organization. One thing you have to understand about the American Studies vote is that only about 16% of the membership voted for it. But so few people participated in the vote that it was the majority of those voting. And that's why you have to be active. That's why there's no university in the U.S. that I'm aware of that is considering a boycott of Israel, because there are factors out there and groups who counterbalance it. There are trustees, there are presidents, there are alums, there are students, there are others. But when the faculty, when the anti-Israel faculty can operate within their professional organization where only they participate and only they vote, relatively small numbers can take over an organization. And that's what's happened to the American Studies Organization. They're bragging on Twitter and elsewhere about how much time they're going to devote at their upcoming conference in November, in Los Angeles, by the way. Okay? The, Wilshire Weston, the Weston Hotel in Los Angeles, is hosting a conference at which, if you are an Israeli academic representing an Israeli institution, you should be barred under their rules. So I think it would be certainly fair for the community to let the owner of that hotel know that that sort of discrimination is not appreciated.
Coincidentally, today, because I'm on the mailing list of a group called AMCHER, A-M-C-H-E-R-E, you remember that?
Yes.
It was an email wherein the people who received it were requested to call Chancellor Block, UCLA, or send him an email and urge his condemning of the BDS. So I called the Chancellor's office and asked that my message be given to the Chancellor, and the lady who answered said, yes, it would. When I happened to ask her, I said, have you had many calls today? She said, are you kidding? A lot of them. I then said, and what side of the fence were they on? She said, they all called with the same request that you did. I thought that was very encouraging.
That's why you're entitled to get involved. You're entitled to get involved.
Well, you know, I sort of beg to disagree with you, because you to me, the BDS is widespread. It's in Irvine, and living here in California, and UCLA, the scandal a few weeks ago. And it's so insidious, and it's so, you, of course, take the legal viewpoint. Now, boycotts, to me, it sort of smacks of dictatorial regimes. You had one in the 30s, in 1933, when all Jewish academicians, scientists, etc., and artists were dismissed from jobs. In the Soviet Union, I worked 20 years for Radio Liberty, distances before them. And as you said, and I agree with you, it was not, to me, it's sort of, where am I? Which planet do I live? You know, it's so dictatorial that this, and let's call it a spade a spade. It's Arab, it's Islamist, and it's Palestinians. And it's terrible. I mean, you're trying to fight them with legal means, but I think the gentleman here, that one has to be more offensive, is right. Because it spreads like bushfire. And our students and the, you know, our teachers, regrettably, are a total failure.
Well, let me address
that. You know, it's a very emotional issue for me personally.
Yeah, let me address
because
a couple.
70 years after the war, almost, you know, to have to, in a free society like the States, and I know about the Constitution and what have you, but the Jewish community is keeping a very low profile and trying to fight it legally, and it's not being publicized.
Let me address a few of the points that you raise. I don't think you can say that it's solely Arab and Islamist. That's certainly part of it. The most destructive people on campuses when it comes to Israel are left-wing Jews. Okay? So I don't think that you can say, and let me, it's true, Jewish Voice for Peace is the most active, okay? The, well, I'm not a psychiatrist. I'm not disagreeing with you, but I'm not a psychiatrist, so I can't express a view. But the point is, and I want to give you an anecdote, which is why I don't think you should just assume that just because somebody is Muslim, they're anti-Israel. I was invited to Vassar. I couldn't find anybody to invite me to Vassar. Vassar now has an open Hillel. The student leader of the Hillel at Vassar is anti-Zionist. Okay. The professor, the head of Jewish studies, signed the boycott letter. You know who invited me to campus? The student founder of the Vassar Conservative Libertarian Union, who is Muslim. So you cannot say, while I agree that Islamist, political Islam is active in this area, so is political left-wing Judaism, and you cannot write off entire populations just because of what their religion is or where they come from. There's that Arab student who just posted a video in solidarity with the three Israeli teens. Now, he may not be the majority, but I think it would be a big mistake to try to do what they want us to do. They want us to turn this into white Jews versus people of color. And if you play into that, you're playing right into their hands, because that's what they want. That's why one of the big academic movements they have, and you've probably heard this in conjunction with UCLA and elsewhere, a lot of the rhetoric, is trying to compare the security barrier in Israel to the fencing along the U.S.-Mexican border. To join solidarity, they say, to Mexican-American student groups. Our fight is your fight. We're in this together. And if we write off entire communities, we're doing exactly what they want us to do.
I'm going to just try and make this into a larger issue. Given the fact that I think everybody in the room knows that Jews are the canary of the world, and if there's going to be fascism, oppression, it's going to hit Jews first and hardest. We know that, but I'm concerned about the rising of fascism, group thinking, and I'm going to give some examples. The debate on global warming is over. Example number one. Example number two, if you happen to be against gay marriage, you're anti-gay. If you happen to think that you have concerns about the way that the welfare system works, you're racist. And everything turns into a groupthink mentality, which is all liberalism and leftism, whatever you want to call it. And I think that this is all part of the basic degeneration of universities and free speech and open debate on issues where you can say, you know, I'm for gay marriage, you're against it, but you say your points, I'll say my points, and an open debate, which is what universities are supposed to be about. And I think that, again, I'll get back to what I said, Jews are the canary. So that's, and thank you for what you're doing.
Yeah. Well, I'm not sure you can compare them all, and certainly those are issues, if we were to start debating them tonight, I would not make my flight tomorrow. So I don't think, you know, you have to, I think there is a destruction of freedom of thought on campuses. There is a destruction of debate on campuses. And that I think that that is a problem. I don't, and that does manifest itself in the fact that if you're a pro-Israeli speaker, there's a significant likelihood your speech is going to be disrupted. If you're an Israeli speaker, it's almost a one-to-one ratio. But that doesn't happen the other way around. When is the last time on a U.S. campus pro-Israel students shouted down an anti-Israel speaker? It doesn't happen. So I think that the breakdown in general is a valid point, but I don't think we have to mix the issues because they're very different issues. And I think that the Israel issue, at least in the United States, is an issue that can and should cut across those traditional conservative liberal lines. And one of the issues, the head of J Street at Vassar was interviewed by the student newspaper because what the student, who is Muslim, who invited me as a protest against the apartheid wall, erected the wall of truth put out by the Horowitz Center. It was immediately defaced and Vassar ordered it taken down because it didn't have a permit and it was too disruptive during finals. Okay. So that's what happens, you know. And Vassar, as far as I know, has done nothing. We have a photo. I published it on my website. A student who was in the area when it was being defaced anonymously sent me, or requesting anonymity, sent it to me, of the picture of one of the students actually defacing it. Is that person going to be prosecuted? Is that person going to be brought up on charges? Horowitz Center people are here. I think they should insist that Vassar enforce their rules against that person.
College students are young, naive, impressionable, open-minded, wonderful. The anti-Israel movement has been phenomenally successful in claiming the moral language that has animated us for the past 50 years. The language that animated the anti-war movement in the 60s, the language that animated the civil rights movement. They have claimed it so well that the pro-Israel advocates on campus can't get that language back, and their moral status is so diminished in the eyes of the campus and in the students. Do you have any observations about how that language could be reclaimed? Because that seems to me key in the intellectual lines.
I'd say there are two fights that are going on. There's the short term and the long term. You're not going to reclaim that language and that moral high ground in the minds of students who for 10 years, beginning in high school, have been subjected to this sort of thing. You can start to turn it around by insisting on fairness in the classroom, insisting that pro-Israeli speakers not be disrupted. I think Jewish groups, or I should say pro-Israel groups, should be able to present alternative programming, and I encourage that. Because you have to almost construct on some of these campuses an alternative educational system, because Israel will not get a fair shake in the classroom. That is a multi-decade project, because it took multi-decades for us to get where we are now. It's not unwinnable, but it's a long-term fight. Then there's the short-term fight, which is defeating these divestment initiatives and really trying to reclaim, you know, the initiative on campuses. And I think both have to be done. I don't think you can reclaim that language overnight, but I think that if you start bringing to campuses people to discuss what goes on in some of the countries, discuss what goes on in the Palestinian territories, how honor killings have doubled recently, what freedom of the press is there in the Palestinian territories? Why is it that there are dozens and dozens of these non-governmental organizations funded mostly by the EU countries, which every morning they wake up in Israel and they have one objective. It's to find something wrong with Israel and to publicize it and to get it into the newspapers. You don't find that in the Palestinian territories because they'd shoot these people or they'd imprison them. And so you have Israel subjected to this hyper-scrutiny under a microscope while other problems are ignored. But those problems are not unknown. And I think it's fair for pro-Israel groups to bring speakers, just as the anti-Israel groups bring speakers discussing the problems in Israel to bring speakers discussing the problems in the Arab world with how they treat women and how minorities are treated and how it takes place in the Palestinian authorities and the rhetoric used by some of the imams. You know, how Jews are the descendants of, you know, monkeys and pigs. And I think students have no clue. So I think you've got to construct an alternative education system that presents the reality. I'm not saying say anything that's false, but say things that are true. So, but if that's, that changing the language is not going to take place in a year or two. And by the way, I do want to point out that when I say high schools, after a speech that I gave to a Jewish lawyers organization, a woman approached me who is not actually a lawyer, but she was attending it anyway. I think she might have worked in a courthouse, or her husband did. And she's a social studies teacher, high school social studies teacher on Long Island in Queens. And she said, I just attended a regional training program for social studies teachers. She said, I almost wanted to vomit. They brought in somebody who is affiliated with Jewish Voice for Peace, who spent 2 hours bashing Israel and telling us how social studies teachers should instruct their students to be in all these negative aspects. So this is taking place not just at college campuses, it's taking place in secondary schools, and for all I know, in elementary schools as well.
Hey, I'm working my way across, and I'll be back to everybody. But I, you know, with reference to the 17-year-old Arab boy who, in the video the other day, supported with three kidnapped boys, I don't know if anybody knows, but his parents, his family, were arrested because they were going to harm him or take him to Jenin. And that, so freedom of speech is not a real big thing on that side of Israel.
Also, just to add to what you said, all sorts of people coming up, you know, I guess the Twitter and Facebook media are good places to express these opinions against the BDS movement. Yep. But my question, and I think I understand the answer from your talk tonight, just because student organizations or student governments, such as what almost happened at UCLA recently, may or may not vote to have a BDS movement, doesn't mean that the administration or the faculty, the administration of the school has to go along with what a student government might say. Is that correct?
That's true, I think, everywhere, but it's still very destructive to the atmosphere on campus when the student government passes it, because they're purporting to speak on behalf of the student body. And I think one of the, there are many effective arguments. So I've watched a lot of these live feeds, the Google Hangouts, of these debates that go on. And unfortunately, because so many of them go on in California, as I'm watching it, my wife is yelling, when are you coming to bed? Because it's 1 a.m. and you guys are just getting started. And so it's one of the effective arguments, and it's not the only one, is that where there is a divided campus on this issue, the student government has no right to purport to commit the entire student body to something. So I think that's a very important distinction. But I do think it's very destructive when these resolutions pass, because they try to build on each other. They say, well, look, 5 have done it, so now it's okay.
And you're saying that the majority of universities in this country have not.
Yes, if there are whatever, 2,000 plus, 3,000 plus, how many have actually passed the resolutions at the student level? 5, 6, 10, I mean, but they're high, they tend to be at high profile places. When it happens at UCLA, it gets national attention. When they try to do it at University of Michigan, it's, you know, there's a reason they select these places, because if it took place at some place you've never heard of, it wouldn't get them the publicity that they want.
Professor Jacobson, you mentioned that there were various opinions as to the legality of Israel's so-called occupation of Judea and Samaria. And you had also mentioned quite correctly that there was a solid legal foundation under international law for Jewish sovereignty in British Mandate and Palestine. And so I'm just wondering, what, on what legal grounds are the opposing arguments based?
The opposing arguments are based, they assert that the Geneva Convention, the Fourth Geneva Convention applies, and that the transfer of population into territory that is occupied is against international law. I've read their arguments. I can't tell you whether they're right or wrong, but our argument is relatively simple and straightforward. Their argument takes 200 pages, like it did with the International Court of Justice, which issued its ruling against the security barrier. It took them 200 pages to try to figure out why it was against international law. So I think that, you know, I find their arguments to be convoluted, so I can't really regurgitate them properly. But they basically say that because the Geneva Convention applies, and Israel disputes that it applies, that the transfer of populations into an area is against the Geneva Convention. The pushback to that is that that convention was written based on the forcible transfer of populations that took place by Germany and others to prevent that. It wasn't meant to prevent, certainly not to prevent the return of a population to its ancestral homeland, but that there were no forced transfers of Jews into Judea and Samaria, that it's entirely voluntary. But that's basically the argument, that it's occupied territory and that you can't transfer your population into it. And I'm not saying that those are frivolous arguments. All I'm saying is that you could have reasonable people who differ on them, but that's not how it's presented when the issue comes up. They say, well, of course, it's almost said in passing. Sure. You can get to me a couple of different ways. One is just to Google my name, and you'll find a number of entries for me, including very horrendous Photoshops that people have done of me.
Can you?
But it's also legal insurrection. But again, just Google William Jacobson, you will find it. Legal insurrection.
Dr. Jacobson, can you comment on the funding of these groups on campus? And could the funding, if the funding was public, would that discredit any of these groups?
I don't know who funds the more national people who do this, but many of the groups get funding from their universities. They qualify as student organizations, and they get the same funding that other student organizations get.
My question pertains to the comment made by the gentleman who left about it's time for the whale to sink the boat, which I thought was very clear. This gentleman's comments about silencing the debate. And I want to give an example and ask what your thinking is. You know, we're talking about a microcosm in the campus. But when John Kerry adopts the apartheid state openly in an international forum representing our country, and then less than a few weeks later, he's suggesting that America will now perhaps in Vienna meet with Iran, and maybe we have something in common with them. This is, and the debate, my question to you pertains to the macro debate. This, in my lifetime, this was shocking. But for people who lived through World War II, I mean, how can we possibly not debate this? And I saw very little media, very few, maybe Charles Cross Thomas, but very few people. And how can you address the consequence of the whale and the boat when you have our own Secretary of State saying, oh, let's negotiate with you?
I don't have a good answer.
I don't think Israel can fight this war alone. Jews all over the world, us, we have to help Israel. We have to teach our children, grandchildren, our neighbors, friends, relatives. We have to know the facts. You know the facts, you stand on very strong ground. Don't be embarrassed, even if you are politically, you think you are incorrect.
You know, one thing that, and I think you can't give your children over to the school system, whether it's private school or public, and just be amazed that 10 years later, what has been created, after almost every one of these speeches, and I don't know if it'll happen tonight, somebody comes up to me with this kind of, you know, sorrowful look on their face and say, I've basically lost my son or my daughter to this movement. They've bought into it. At almost every speech that happens, where the crowd isn't a student crowd, it's an adult crowd. And I say, well, what did you do? I mean, you were asleep at the wheel for 15 years, and now you wake up, and they want to join Jewish Voice for Peace and ride the flotilla into Gaza. Where were you the last 15 years? You can't abdicate your own responsibility.
You mentioned that there's a movement now to equate the barrier wall in Israel with the wall that we should have here, uh-huh. partially have right. here at our border. part of the problem is that especially in the Southwest, we have many Hispanic students. They belong to an organization called MECHA, M-E-C-H-A, which says that the Mexicans and the Central Americans should take America back. They play against the color, you know, the dark-skinned people against the white, light-skinned people, and also that we shouldn't have any fences, any borders. And go to their website. There is a lot of anti-Semitic stuff on there, and they're more than happy to join with the BDS people. And so we really have to be aware of the Hispanic population that's coming into this country.
And what I'd say about that is that's true, that what has happened, is, but this is, again, not something that developed overnight. This has been the strategy since, at least I've been conscious of it, since the early 80s. And I would not write off any ethnic or religious or racial groups. That's what they want you to do. And I would engage in outreach to other Hispanics who don't agree with that, who I think there's, at least based on the polling, there's tremendous splits of opinion on immigration and other issues. And I think that I just don't think you abandon it and say, well, okay, you know, this student group is saying this, therefore we've lost that fight. I think that sort of outreach is extremely important.
This is the last question.
Yeah. And my question, though, goes back to the latest vote in the Council of Conference of Presidents of Major Jewish Organizations, where reform is now shilling or Jason.
Where who is?
Reform is shilling for Jason.
Well, I'm not, you know, as familiar with that. You know, I think the J Street debate is one that's worth having. What I've seen on campuses has been a mixed bag. Okay, at Cornell, J Street U, Hillel, and CPAC, Cornell Israel Public Affairs, so the Cornell student group affiliated with APAC, all were completely united, no separation whatsoever in terms of fighting a boycott resolution, so much so that they killed it in a pre-hearing motion, which drove them crazy. They motioned to table it indefinitely because everybody came together. At other campuses, I've seen less cooperation. At Vassar, I've now become the Vassar expert. At Vassar, so you had the week before I appeared, you had two of the worst anti-Israel speakers, Max Blumenthal and Ali Abunima, appear at the invitation with the sponsorship of multiple academic units, academic departments. It was an SJP, Students for Justice in Palestine event, but multiple departments sponsored it, including the Jewish Studies Department, 2 days after that. So that was the Wednesday before my Monday speech. The Friday before my Monday speech, the J Street U branch at Vassar, which is new, relatively new, brought three speakers, one of whom was from Jewish Voice for Peace, I forget the entities that the other two were affiliated with, but I know people who attended that. They said it was just as bad as the Max Blumenthal Ali Abunima. So they invited anti-Israel. There was nobody on the three-person panel who was even remotely positive to Israel. And I've heard that has happened at many other colleges and universities. And you can't spend 2 hours bashing Israel, dehumanizing it, and then at the end stand up and say, but we want it to exist, because you've then lost the premise for its existence. And I think that's a debate that should take place. And I think J Street should have to defend what it does on campuses. And it should have to defend why, at some campuses at least, I can't say it's national, at some campuses at least, the speakers invited by Students for Justice in Palestine are indistinguishable from the speakers invited by J Street U. That's not to say they don't have a right to do it, that they should be barred. I'm not saying that. But it's a fair point of debate.
Thank you very much.